Please stand. And of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. A reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 1. Hear this, O nations, and listen, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I have raised children and brought them up, but they have rebelled against me. The ox knows its owner, and the donkey knows its owner's manager. But Israel does not know. My people do not understand. How terrible it will be for that sinful nation, for a people loaded with guilt, offspring who act wickedly, children who are corrupt. They have forsaken the Lord. They have despised the Holy One of Israel. They have deserted him and turned back. Why do you keep earning more beatings? Why do you continue to rebel? Your whole head is wounded, your whole heart is weak. From the sole of your foot to the top of your head, there is nothing healthy, but only wounds, welts, and open sores. Your wounds have not been cleaned, or bandaged, or soothed with olive oil.
We are all God's children, and He is our Father, for He made us, and He provides for us. But we have been disobedient children, and disowned our Father, making us unworthy of His love, and deserving of His anger and punishment. But God loves us even without us deserving it, and so He made a plan to save us from the punishment we deserve by sending a Son who would be obedient. Therefore, the Lord himself will give him a sign for all of you. Look, the virgin will conceive and give him birth to a son and name him Emmanuel.
Isaiah chapter 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. For those living in the land of the shadow of death, the light has dawned. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased the joy for it. They rejoice before you like the joy at harvest time, like the celebration when people divide the plunder. For you have shattered the yoke that burdened them. You have broken the bar on their shoulders and the rod of their oppressor, as you did in the day of Midian. Every boot that marched in battle and the garments rolled in blood will be burned. They will be fuel for the fire.
In order to save all mankind from his disobedience to God, Emmanuel needed to not only be simple himself, but powerful enough to take on the sins of the whole world. But only God himself could be that powerful, so God decided to send his very own son, who shares with him an equal Godhead. For us a child is born, to us a son is given. The authority to rule will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
To be the Savior of mankind, God the Son had to become a man, but he could not be born in a normal way, for all who is born in a normal way by human parents are born in sin, receiving a sinful nature from their parents. So God appointed a young woman, the Virgin Mary, to be the mother of Emmanuel, the mother of God, not by human flesh and blood, but by the power of the Spirit of God.
A reading from Luke chapter 1. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin pledged in marriage to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But she was greatly troubled by the statement and was wondering what kind of greeting this could be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, because you have found favor with God. Listen, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end." Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Listen, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, even though she was called barren, and this is her sixth month. For nothing will be impossible for God." Then Mary said, "See, I am the Lord's servant. May it happen to me as you have said." Then the angel left her.
Mary was pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, but finding out that she was with child before he had taken her as his wife was concerning, and he planned to end the relationship. But Gabriel came to Joseph and assured him that Mary had not been unfaithful to him, but rather she had been chosen to bear God in the flesh, and he had been chosen to be the guardian of the Christ child, Emmanuel.
A reading from Matthew chapter 1. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ took place. His mother, Mary, was pledged in marriage to Joseph. Before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to disgrace her, so he decided to divorce her privately. But as he was considering these things, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this happened to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Look, the virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will name him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife.
The prophecy that a virgin would give birth to a son was about to be fulfilled, but now there was another prophecy to be fulfilled. Joseph and Mary were both descendants of King David, and so this royal child would be born in King David's hometown, Bethlehem.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governing Syria. And everyone went to register, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the town of Nazareth, into Judea, to the town of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was with Mary, his wife, who was pledged to him in marriage and was expecting a child. And so it was that while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Even though Emmanuel, the God of all creation, had been born in such a lonely state, the birth of the Savior of all mankind could not go unannounced. So God sent his heavenly messengers, the angels, to announce the birth of his son to the shepherds outside of Bethlehem.
There were, in the same country, shepherds staying out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior was born for you. He is Christ the Lord, and this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly there was with an angel a multitude from the heavenly army praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward mankind."
Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail incarnate deity. Pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heavenly Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Now let's go to Bethlehem and see the thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger.
When the shepherds went to see what the Lord had told them about, they hurried and ran, and found the age-old prophecies of Isaiah fulfilled before their very eyes. They saw the promised Emmanuel, the one who would be their Savior for all their sin. They saw the love of God right there, the love no one could ask for and no one could earn, the love that does not force its way into our hearts, but the love that enters into our hearts by grace.
Where shepherds lately knelt and kept the angel's word, I come in half belief, a pilgrim strangely stirred. But there is room and welcome there for me. But there is room and welcome there for me. In that unlikely place I find him as they said. Sweet newborn babe, how frail and in a manger bed. A still small voice to cry one day for me. A still small voice to cry one day for me. How should I not have known Isaiah would be there? His prophecies fulfilled, with pounding heart I stand. A child, a son, a prince of peace for me. A child, a son, the prince of peace for me. Can I, will I forget how love was born and burned? Its way into my heart unasked, unforced, unearned. To die, to live, and not alone for me. To die, to live, and not alone for me.
But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart.
Without a doubt, Mary had been chosen for a wonderful purpose. But one day, she would also suffer a great grief, to see the very son she held and loved too close be crucified and suffer the burden and pain of the whole world's sin. Whenever we see the Christ child, we must always remember that this was the whole reason he was born. This was the reason for Christmas.
Having become our brother by becoming a human, being born of the Virgin Mary, Jesus grew up and was perfectly obedient to our Heavenly Father. Then he sacrificed himself on the cross to pay for the punishment that our sins deserved. Jesus did this so that we would become his brothers and sisters, so that we would become God's children too.
But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son to be born of a woman, so that he would be born under the law, in order to redeem those under the law, so that we would be adopted as sons.
A reading from Isaiah chapter 9. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. For those living in the land of the shadow of death, the light has dawned. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you like the joy at harvest time, like the celebration when people divide the plunder. For you have shattered the yoke that burdened them. You have broken the bar on their shoulders and the rod of their oppressor, as you did in the day of Midian. Every boot that marched in battle and the garments rolled in blood will be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The authority to rule will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no limit to his authority and no end to the peace he brings. He will rule on David's throne and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from now on into eternity. The zeal of the Lord of armies will accomplish this. The word of the Lord. You know, unlike some people I know, I like the winter. I don't mind the cold, really, and when it snows, which I wish it had today, I find it rather beautiful. However, there's one thing about winter I don't like. It's the short days, the excessive darkness. Just a few days ago was the winter solstice, the day with the least daylight in the northern hemisphere. The darkness is really the only thing I just can't stand about winter. It makes me tired, it makes me slow. There's a whole disorder about it called seasonal affective disorder. Darkness and the aversion to it is something fairly universal. Sight is a very important part of our lives. Being able to navigate and find our way around is very important, and darkness makes getting lost much, much easier. I know I hate having to drive in the dark. By nature, all human beings are walking in darkness. The darkness of sin. We are lost in it. And the only things we'll ever find in that darkness are our enemies of death and sin. But God is not satisfied to leave us in this condition, lost in darkness. So he shines a great light in it. He shines the light of Emmanuel. Come and see Emmanuel. He shines in the darkness, and he destroys our enemies that lurk in it. In these past few chapters of Isaiah, God has been giving Isaiah some signs. In one sense, he tells Isaiah that his own sons are signs. He has Isaiah name his sons names that prophesy events that are to come, like the coming invasion of the northern kingdom by Assyria. But in chapter 7, he first describes the sign of Emmanuel. Emmanuel in Hebrew means God with us. Isaiah says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give a sign for all of you. Look, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and name him Emmanuel. The spiritual darkness that Israel found itself at that time, many centuries ago, was parallel to the political darkness they were in. At this time, they were surrounded by enemies. Everyone seemed to be scheming to destroy them, but God would deliver them. In fact, he would provide an even greater deliverance. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. For those living in the land of the shadow of death, the light has dawned. In these dark times, where it seems that all around is darkness and death, God will shine forth with light and life. And there will be joy, joy like in harvest time, like after a victory in a war. This Emmanuel, God with us, will shine a light in the darkness of sin and death. By nature, we are lost and we have no hope. But Emmanuel comes and gives us hope. He shines a light to lead us out of the darkness. Emmanuel doesn't just shine a light in the darkness, but all those enemies that lurk in darkness, sin and death, he destroys them. All their weapons and armor are eradicated. And how does this Emmanuel, this light, come into the world? For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The authority to rule will rest on his shoulders. He will be named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. A child is born, a son is given. And who is this child? He is the mighty God, God with us, Emmanuel. This light is a child who is God in human flesh. This child is Jesus Christ, whose birth we celebrate this Christmas. When you look at all the lights we put up for Christmas, on our trees, on our homes, everywhere, all of that is remembering Jesus Christ, the light of the world, who came into our darkness to lead us out and bring us peace. Isaiah says, there will be no limit to his authority and no end to the peace he brings. Emmanuel brings endless peace, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. This is how Emmanuel brings us peace. He became a human being, God and man in one person, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Our God, united to human flesh, pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus, the very Son of God, being true God himself, one with the Father, was pleased to dwell with us, to be born as a human child, like us. But one difference. Emmanuel would be without sin, without darkness. He would not be lost. He would lead the way out of the darkness. He would live a life without sin, and he would take that life to a cross of wood to be executed, though perfectly innocent. Instead, he took on our guilt. Our sin. Isaiah later prophesies about Emmanuel. He was crushed for the guilt our sins deserved. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all have gone astray like sheep. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has charged all our guilt to him. We are all guilty of wandering in the darkness of depravity, of sinning against God, and by it, we earned ourselves eternal punishment and damnation in hell. But all of that guilt and punishment was placed on Emmanuel, for only God himself could have the power to bear such a burden. But he had to be man like us to suffer man's burden for sin. And Emmanuel was victorious in that battle against sin, death, and hell, because he took his life up again after he died. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings, he rose from the dead, the very body he was born in and died in. He took up again and lived once more, forever, never to die again. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Emmanuel laid aside full use of his divine glory and was born to die, so that we would not die eternally, but be given a new birth, free from sin and all its consequences. In this Emmanuel, this light of the world, you have full and free forgiveness from all the punishments of sin that you've earned. By believing in this holy child, you are led out of the darkness and into light. Your sins are burned away by the light of Emmanuel. And like that child who was born and died and rose again to live forever eternally, by faith in that child, you too are born and you will die. But trusting in Emmanuel and his cross, you will be raised to live again forever and ever in paradise, in a land where there is no darkness, no sin, no suffering, and no pain. So come and see Emmanuel. He will lead you out of darkness and into everlasting light. He will free you from the oppression of sin and death and give you life eternal. Amen. Please stand. We will now join in singing the Apostles' Creed together on page 9 of the bulletin.
Day and night.
possessing an equal Godhead throne and might, source of every grace and blessing. Born of Mary, Virgin Mother, by the power of the Spirit, made true man our elder brother, that the lost might life inherit, was crucified for sinful man, and raised by God to life again. We all confess the Holy Ghost, who in highest heaven dwelling with God the Father and the Son, comforts us beyond all telling. Who the Church his own creation keeps in unity of spirit, here forgiveness and salvation daily come through Jesus' merit. All flesh shall rise, and we shall be in bliss with God eternally. Please be seated for prayer. O gracious and almighty Father, we praise you that you kept your ancient promises by sending your everlasting Son in human flesh. You sent Jesus as a lowly child to demonstrate your concern for all, the weak and lonely, the troubled and frightened, the timid and helpless. No one is overlooked by your ever-seeking eyes. No one is excluded from your upholding arms. No one is denied the comfort and help of your outstretched hand. You sent Jesus as the Savior of the world to deliver all from the curse of sin, the power of death, and the torment of hell. He took our place. He was born under the law to set us free. He became the innocent lamb of sacrifice. He came to die and rise again in order that we might live eternally. Firmly implant this good news in our hearts and fill us with an eager desire to spread the word concerning what we have heard tonight. You sent Jesus as the light of the world to drive out all darkness that would rob us of the full life that you intend for us. May the joy that will be for all people be our joy. May the peace on earth to all on whom his favor rests be our peace. May the treasure that Mary pondered in her heart be our treasure. Please stand. We join in the prayer that our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Before we close with our recessional hymn, just a few announcements. First of all, a thank you all for coming out here and worshiping with us to celebrate the birth of our Lord. I wish you all a very Merry Christmas, and I also invite all of you to come and celebrate with us again tomorrow morning at our Christmas Day service, which will be at 9 o'clock a.m. There was some confusion with certain schedules, but tomorrow's Christmas Day service is at 9 o'clock a.m. We hope to see you all there. It's another wonderful opportunity to celebrate our Lord's birth. We join in closing with the recessional hymn then.